welcome to LA's The Place. I'm Jeff Gaskin, and today joining me is a great actor, writer, and director, Patrick Kilpatrick. How are you doing today?
I'm very well, thanks. It's a pleasure to see you.
Likewise. Now, you've had a career that has really spanned several genres of television and film. I mean, you've got to be one of the hardest working actors in television. I heard, in fact, in an 18-month period, you did 5 feature films, a handful of indies, and made 27 guest appearances on 18 different TV shows. How do you find the time, and is the answer cloning?
I think the answer is to have a family, and you've got to feed kids.
Motivation?
Yeah, if I didn't go out and work as an actor, particularly at that time, my kids are kind of, one is in college now, and the other's a freshman in high school. If I didn't book the job, then they didn't get to eat. So it was a big motivator. I became a very, very motivated auditioner, and I think that's really the key. People don't really realize auditioning is very hard work. The reality is that you will get the material at, say, the agent maybe sends it over at 6 o'clock at night, and maybe if you've got a life or you're working for a charity or you've got kids, you won't even get home until 8 or 9. So generally you'll get that that material quite late, and then on the next day you've got an 11 o'clock audition and you have to be performance ready. So I kind of made a science out of doing that. In fact, I teach it at universities a couple of times a year, 3 or 4. And I very early on I came to the conclusion that if you weren't a brilliant auditioner, you weren't going to get a chance to really become a good actor. So I developed a way of doing it really fast and keeping it fun, and you go in and you bang down the work, you deliver the goods, really, because the faint heart don't do that. I see a lot of other actors, and they're not booking work, and it usually can be come down to audition technique. The other thing is, I was a writer before I was an actor, and I think that having the mind of a writer is a very, very wonderful compliment to anybody who's acting.
Is it also true in directing as well? Does it really cross over? You can understand what to expect from actors because you've been one yourself when you direct?
There's no question about that. I thought you were going to say, does being a writer help you to be a director? I think it does, but I love to fire writers as soon as I possibly can as the producer. I even love firing myself. I mean, I'll write a script and then I'll sort of pull away from the process and bring another person in, usually a filmmaker who's working in tandem with me to add what they add. Our scripts are often very collaborative. But there's no question, being a writer, knowing how to direct, knowing the methodology of filmmaking and all its aspects, helps you to be a better actor. And you know, it's funny, when young actors often sometimes don't get this. They go, you know, I don't want to be a producer, and I don't want to be an a writer and a director. I want to be an actor. The truth is, if you learn about those other things, something chemically happens differently to you, and you become a better actor. I mean, I've gotten a lot of work sometimes because the directors knew I could polish the script. A lot of times you're in such a not a very good project, and you can elevate some of your lines. Let's take an example like Billy Bob Thornton. I knew he was a writer long before he became a star with Sling Blade, because I would see him in these not so good movies and he'd have the best lines. So I knew he was coming up with his own lines. And I've done movies where almost every line that I've said, I've written.
So do you find a lot of directors will give you a lot more leeway relative to the other actors on set in those terms of changing your lines or polishing them?
Well, it's all about trust, you know. Sometimes, you have to be diplomatic. I'll go to a director and I'll say, look, do you mind if I do this as a South African, and do you mind if I say this and such and such? Usually the good ones will say, well, let's give it a try. Let's take a look and see how it works, and if it works, and then you deliver the goods. Let's take, for example, if the writer is the director, then if they're secure in themselves, they won't mind if you sort of go off a little bit and, mm-hmm. and make up some things. But you don't want to overdo it. It's not about, it's about compelling whatever story you've got and style that is exercising there into a better place. I come from a school where if it's on the page, you figure out a way to say it appropriately. But there are times when a line change is good and you just say, hey, may I do this? Or may I do that? And it's okay. They're the captain of the ship in that case, and they get to decide.
You've appeared on screen opposite some of Hollywood's biggest names, and we know you're a great actor because you convinced us you all actually got your ass kicked by Tom Cruise in Minority Report.
Yeah.
But, you know, when you go up against Bruce Willis, James Caan, Arnold Schwarzenegger, are you ever intimidated on set
by... Physically? No.
Not physically, but by their acting, their kind of general reputation?
No. I wouldn't say so. I mean, you know, I was an athlete before I was an actor, and, you know, I worked with Sean Connery, and... No, I think it's the sort of competitive, sort of athletic person in me. Mm-hmm. I was not. I mean, do I admire somebody like Sean Connery? Sure. But would I, as an actor in a scene, let them roll over me? No. Mm-hmm. No. You never want to let go of your character's drives and whatever's motivating them. So, no. I can't think of, even if it was Marlon Brando, would I have been intimidated by them. I work really hard to be prepared, mm-hmm. and I'm often, I think, more prepared than most people, and really leave no stone unturned in that, so no, not at all. People like James Caan, you mentioned, he's actually a blast to work with,
yeah.
and I've worked with him several times. It's like working with a borscht belt comedian, you know, he's constantly doing jokes, or... Arnold or Bruce. Bruce was great. You know, I loved working with Bruce because Bruce was an actor. Some of the guys I've worked with prior to that in films were mostly martial artists and mm-hmm. fighters and had sort of taken that route into acting. Not that they're not interesting guys to work with and all of that, but I appreciated where Bruce's origins are, which were similar to mine, which was... you know, the New York stage and mm-hmm. that kind of thing.
Now, you've also appeared against some of, kind of, like you mentioned, martial arts, big stars, Jean-Claude Van Damme, Chow Yun-Fat, even Walker, Texas Rangers, you were going against the great Chuck Norris.
Uh-huh.
Which of those guys, even Steven Seagal, were really tough on-screen and off-screen that you were like, wow, this guy is really owning it?
Well, you wouldn't want to get kicked in the head by Jean-Claude Van Damme either, but or Chuck Norris. But really, I think the most deadly of those guys is Steven Seagal.
Really?
Well, yeah, Steven is not only a martial artist, but he's a shooter. And I'm a shooter as well. And I think at the time I did Under Siege 2 with him, he was doing about 10,000 rounds a week with pistols and stuff.
Wow.
So... he really does know his stuff. There's a difference between competitive martial arts and the killing arts.
Mm-hmm.
And Steven's had a lot of work on the killing arts. There's also a mindset. You know, Chuck Norris, rough guy. There's no question about it. But he's a competitor.
Mm-hmm.
Jean-Claude, more than most people realize, is almost more like a ballet dancer in his conditioning and all of that, and the way he defines fights. Steven is a guy who could really take you out if he really needed to.
Hmm.
The others would be, you know, I wouldn't be afraid of them.
Now, you're often given the role of the villain, the bad guy.
Yeah.
Are you drawn to those roles, or has Hollywood kind of typecast you or really seized you as the villain?
I'm actually more drawn to stuff that has depth, whether it's good guy, bad guy. I recently did the lead in a pilot that I hope is going to get picked up. And the guy was a binge-drinking, cigar-smoking priest who also killed the undead and was having an affair with a nun. So my friend said, well, Patrick, that's not even a stretch for you. But... all you have to do is say the lines. But the part had a lot of color to it.
And yeah.
That's what I'm drawn to. I think most of it is typecasting. Okay. You know, we live in a business that's supposed to be devoted to vision, but there's not an awful lot sometimes. Mm-hmm. And it's very easy for people to plug you into things if you do a good job. I think if I'd known it was that strong, that impulse to pigeonhole people, in the beginning, I might have, you only have one choice. You have the choice to say no, and you won't do that work until something different comes along. I chose a different path, which was sort of, I modeled it after Michael Caine, really, which was just to keep working. Mm-hmm. And then you go through phases, you know, you go through guys in a prison cell who are white Aryan supremacist maniacs. And then you go through a phase where you're cowboys who are bad guys who get redeemed, or that kind of thing. And you do those phases for about a year. And then something else comes along and stuff. I think it's typecasting. You take a guy like Rutger Hauer. He was started out a leading man. Then he did such a good job in The Hitcher, he virtually never got out of bad guys after that.
Well, take me back to the beginning of your career. I had heard when you were growing up, you were a great athlete in high school, and maybe you were thinking athletics is your future. Then something happened, and you moved more towards writing and acting. What happened, and how did you respond?
Well, actually, it was a way longer journey than that. When I was 17, I was a passenger in a car, and I actually didn't realize that the fellow who was driving had been drinking, so we had a really bad accident, and I broke my back. And until that time, and came very close to not walking again. So it was a pivotal event, but a good one. What happened was, because I had played football, basketball, baseball, and wrestling, and horseback riding, and all tennis, and all this stuff, I couldn't do that for a number of years. So I got to college, and I still couldn't speak very well, you know, because when you're a football athlete, you're not the most articulate person, particularly in high school. But I had always read books. I read a book a day. My parents wouldn't let me watch much television at the time. So my earliest heroes were literary ones. And so I started wanting to be a writer. And I went to New York after college and managed to get a job writing advertising for magazines. And it was a very literate form of advertising, like Life magazine, if they wanted to do an ad for themselves, and the New York Times and all of that. And so I did that for a while. Then I started writing magazine articles for those magazines. And then I had the notion that real writers did something more than just advertising writing and journalism, that they did novels. So I left Time Incorporated, where I was working at Sports Illustrated and Life and all these places doing advertising and journalism. And to save money, I started splitting a house with a guy who was a British actor who was becoming a huge Broadway director. I knew nothing about acting. I knew nothing about theater. I knew nothing about whatever. So, but to save money, he hired me to do, for $200 a month, while I was writing the novel, to watch his kids while he directed a play. And I ended up at the Williamstown Theater Festival, which is in Massachusetts, and it's kind of summer camp for big time actors like Richard Dreyfuss and Frank Langella, and Christopher Reeves was there. And so I, Blythe Danner, I started watching, and I met people like Gwyneth Paltrow when she was 12, and I sort of became enthralled with this process of the play and the acting. And so I wrote a play instead of a novel, and that got produced in New York. And then I was asked to join theater companies as the play guy, because I was the only guy who could read. And then when they would put the play up that I chose, they would need a guy with a tennis racket or a guy with whatever. Believe it or not, I was like the upper class guy at that time with the tennis racket. And I started acting, and literally it just took off. I mean, I studied acting all around New York, but it was kind of like destiny. You know, I mean, I got a job 3 weeks, a good job, 3 weeks after I started an acting class.
That's pretty impressive. So it seems like you were able to avoid the waiting tables, parking cars, and you got right in.
I didn't do too much of it. I did a little bit in between the high paid advertising. I did a little bit of catering in New York. Some guys who did it with me went on to some really good careers. Lawrence Bender, who produced Pulp Fiction and all of the Reservoir Dogs and all of Quentin Tarantino stuff, he was a caterer with me. But I was a terrible caterer because I would go in the bathroom while everybody was setting up and learn the lines to plays. And then come out just for the show, the actual service of the stuff. But it was actually a cool way to get around Manhattan because you ended up in like Estee Lauder's house or the Museum of Modern History at these great events, and you were fed well and you were paid pretty well. And some of us went on to acting careers.
Interesting. Now, you've had this long, successful career, and now you can look back. And you're also giving back.
Actually, I formed a company called Uncommon Dialogue Films, and we do this. We'll take, if somebody comes to us with a movie project, we'll create the script, create the treatment, burnish it, put it together. We'll take them down the line as producers, consultants, in order for them to get distribution and direct them to where they need to go for financing and help them casting. But it had to become a function of economics because I have a group of films. Imagine if the metaphor is their children, okay, and they have to go to college, and money has already been applied to those children that has to go to college. So if somebody just comes in and wants to become a member of that family, they have to bring some sort of money to it.
What does the future hold for Patrick Kilpatrick? Are you more looking to do acting? Are you really trying to stick more to the writing, directing, and it sounds like getting involved in the producing and financing of films?
Well, a certain amount of this business is kind of an adventure. I mean, I never know what's coming up as well as acting and other people's stuff. And it comes, like I say, it comes fast and furious. Sometimes a director will call you and he's seen your work or he's worked with you before, or sometime you'll get a meeting or an audition for that kind of thing. So I don't really know. I think I'm going to certainly continue to act as it comes up. I've been doing a fair amount of public speaking, the teaching at universities I love to do. I wouldn't want to do it full time, but it's a great rhythm change throughout the year, maybe four or five times. I think it's always going to be a compliment. I do a fair amount of political writing. I'm going to write a book right now. I've been doing some essays. We have actually about 2 years worth of film of these university seminars and teaching things. So we're cutting that right now into an instructional video for somebody, whether they want to be a writer, an actor, director, producer, so that'll be out there. And I want to do a companion book for that because it's really about service to other people. So, because I know there was never a book for what and I read them all. And they were all valuable, but, you know, it's like if you wanted to go to war, which would you rather study with? A sergeant who'd been at the war? Or would you want to talk to somebody theoretically about things?
Yeah.
You'd want to get that time in with the person who'd been at the front, so... I've written some portions of that book, and I'll continue that. But tonight at 7:30 at the Shangri-La Hotel, I have a meeting with some Louisiana investors to fund one of our films. So I'm sure all of that's going to continue.
Well, sounds great. Well, we appreciate you taking time out of your busy schedule to speak with us.
Thank you.